Hi, I'm Toni Clay, and a lot of you might recognize me because I work for the school district as the communications coordinator, which means that I get to have the fun of coming onto campuses and taking pictures and writing stories and making movies. But I am also a member of the Athens City Council. So as a city councilwoman, I work with four other people to try to take good care of the city. And I'm also very excited today to be reading to you from the one and only Ivan. I'm starting on page 68. Would help if I was on page 68. Here we go. Arrival. The new neighbor arrives after the 4 o'clock show. When the truck comes lumbering toward the parking lot, Bob scampers over to inform us. Bob always knows what's happening. He's a useful friend to have, especially when you can't leave your domain. With a groan, Mac lifts the sliding metal door near the food court, the place where the deliveries are made. A big white truck is backing up to the door, belching smoke. When the driver opens the truck, I know Stella is right. A baby elephant is inside. I see her trunk poking out from the blackness. I'm glad for Stella, but when I glance at her, I see she is not glad at all. "Stand back, everyone," Mac yells. "We've got a new arrival. This is Ruby, folks. 600 pounds of fun to save our sorry butts. This gal is gonna sell us some tickets." Mac and two men climb into the black cave of the truck. We hear noise, scuffling, a word Mac uses when he's angry.
Ruby makes a noise, too. Like one of the little trumpets they sell at the gift store. "Move," Mac said, but still, there's no Ruby. "Move," he says again. "We haven't got all day." Inside her domain, Stella paces as much as she's able. 2 steps away, 2 steps the other. She slaps her trunk against rusty metal bars. She grumbles. "Stella," I ask, "did you hear the baby?" Stella mutters something under her breath, a word she uses when she's angry. "Relax, Stella," I say. "It'll be okay." "Ivan," Stella says, "it will never, ever be okay. And I know enough to stop talking." Stella helps. The men are still yelling. Some of the yelling is at each other, but most of it's at Ruby. We hear scrambling, pounding, shifting. The side of the truck shudders. "I'm starting to like this elephant," Bob whispers. "I'm getting the big one," Mac says. "Maybe she can coax the stupid brute out of the truck." Mac opens Stella's door. "Come on, girl," he urges. He unties the rope attached to the floor bolt. Stella pushes past Mac, nearly knocking him over. She rushes as best she can, limping heavily toward the open back door of the truck. She catches her swollen foot on the edge of the ramp and winces. Blood trickles down. Halfway up the ramp, she pauses. The noise of the truck stops. Ruby falls silent. Slowly, Stella makes her way up the rest of the ramp and groans under her weight, and I can tell how much she's hurting by the awkward way she moves. At the top of the incline, she stops. She pokes her trunk into the emptiness. We wait. The tiny gray trunk appears again. Shyly, she reaches out, tasting the air. Stella curls her own trunk around the babies. They make soft, rustling sounds. We wait some more. A hush falls over the entire Big Top Mall. Thud, thud, step, step, pause, step, stop, pause. And there she is, so small she can fit underneath Stella with room to spare. Her skin sags and she sways unsteadily as she makes her way down the ramp. "Not the greatest specimen," Max says, "but I got her cheap from the bankrupt circus out west. They had her shipped over from Africa. Only had her a month before they went bust." He gestures toward Ruby. "Thing is, people love babies, baby elephants, baby gorillas, heck, give me a baby alligator and I could make a killing." Stella ushers Ruby towards her domain. Mac and the two men follow. At Stella's door, Ruby hesitates. Mac gives Ruby a shove, but she doesn't budge. "Doggone it, get a clue, Ruby," he mutters, but Ruby isn't moving and neither is Stella. Mac grabs a broom, he raises it. Instantly, Stella steps in front of Ruby to shield her. "Get in the cage, both of you," Mac shouts. Stella stares at Mac, considering. Gently but firmly using her trunk, she nudges Ruby into her domain. Only then does Stella enter. Mac slams the door shut with a clang. I see two trunks intertwined. I hear Stella whispering. Poor kid, says Bob. Welcome to the Exit 8 Big Top Mall and Video Arcade, home of the one and only Ivan. Old news. When Julia comes, she sits by Stella's domain and watches the new baby. She barely talks to me. Stella doesn't talk to me either. She's too busy nuzzling Ruby. She's cute, little Ruby, with her ears flapping like palm leaves, but I am handsome and strong. Bob trots circle around my belly before settling down in just the right spot. Give it up, Ivan, he says. You're old news. Julia gets out a piece of paper and a pencil. I can see that she's drawing Ruby. I move to the corner of my domain to pout. Bob grumbles. He doesn't like it when I disrupt his naps. Homework, Julia's father scolds. Julia sighs and puts her drawing aside. I grunt and Julia glances in my direction. Poor old Ivan, she says. I've been ignoring you, haven't I? I grunted again, a dignified, indifferent grunt. Julia thinks for a moment and then smiles. She walks over to my domain, to the spot in the corner where the glass is broken. She slides paper through. She rolls a pencil across my cement floor. You can draw a baby elephant too, Julia says. I bite the pencil in half with my magnificent teeth, and then I eat some paper. Tricks. Even after Julia and her father leave, I try to keep sulking, but it's no use. Gorillas are not, by nature, pouters. Stella, I call. It's a full moon. Did you see? Sometimes, when we're lucky, we catch a glimpse of the moon through the skylight in the food court. I did, Stella said. She's whispering, and I realize that Ruby must be asleep. Is Ruby all right, I ask. She's too thin, Ivan, Stella says. Poor baby. She was in that truck for days. Mac bought her from a circus the way he bought me, but she hadn't been there long. She was born in the wild like us. Will she be okay, I ask. Stella doesn't answer my question. The circus trainers chained her to the floor, Ivan, all 4 feet, 23 hours a day. I puzzle over why this would be a good idea. I always try to give humans the benefit of the doubt. Why would they do that, I finally ask. To break her spirit, Stella said. So she could learn to balance on a pedestal, so she could stand on her hind legs, so a dog could jump on her back while she walked in mindless circles. I hear her tired voice, and I think of all the tricks Stella has learned. Introductions. When I wake the next morning, I see a little trunk poking out between the bars of Stella's domain. Hello, says a small, clear voice. I'm Ruby, she waves her trunk. Hello, I said, I'm Ivan. Are you a monkey? Ruby asks. Certainly not. Bob's ears perk up, although his eyes stay closed. He's a gorilla, he says, and I'm a dog of uncertain heritage. Why did the dog climb your tummy? Ruby asks. Because it's there, Bob murmurs. Is Stella awake? I asked. Aunt Stella's asleep, Ruby says. Her foot is hurting, I think. Ruby turns her head. Her eyes are like Stella's, black and long-lashed, bottomless lakes fringed by tall grass. What is breakfast, she asked. Soon, I say, when the mall opens and the workers come. Where? Ruby twists her head to the other direction. Where are the other elephants? It's just you and Stella, I say, and for some reason I feel we have let her down. Are there more of you? Not, I say, at the moment. Ruby picked up a piece of hay and considers it. Do you have a mom and dad? Well, I used to. Everyone has parents, Bob exclaimed. It's unavoidable. Before the circus, I used to live with my mom and my aunts and my sisters and my cousins, Ruby said. She drops the hay, picks it up, twirls it. They're dead. I don't know what to say. I'm not really enjoying this conversation, but I can see that Ruby isn't done talking. To be polite, I say, I'm sorry to hear that, Ruby. Humans killed them, she said. Who else? Bob asked, and we all fall silent. Stella and Ruby. All morning, Stella strokes Ruby, pats her, smells her. They flap their ears. They rumble and roar. They sway as if they're dancing. Ruby clings to Stella's tail. She slips under Stella's belly. Sometimes they just lean into each other, their trunks twirled together like jungle vines. Stella looks so happy. It's more fun to watch them than any nature show I've ever seen on TV. Home of the one and only Ivan. George and Mac are out by the highway. I can see them through one of my windows. They are next to each other on tall wooden ladders, leaning against the billboard that tells the cars to stop and visit the one and only Ivan, Mighty Silverback. George has a bucket and a long-handled broom. Mac has pieces of paper. He slaps one against the billboard. George dips the broom into the bucket. He wets the paper with the liquid from the bucket, and somehow the paper stays in place. They put up many pieces before they're done, and when they climb down from the ladder, I see that they've added a picture of a little elephant to the billboard. The elephant has a lopsided smile. She's wearing a red hat, and her tail curls like a pig's. She doesn't look like Ruby. She doesn't even look like an elephant. I've only known Ruby one day, and I could have drawn her better. Art lessons. Ruby asks a lot of questions. She says, Ivan, why is your tummy so big? And have you ever seen a green giraffe? And can you get me one of those pink clouds that the humans are eating? When Ruby asks, what is that on your wall? I explain that it's a jungle. She says the flowers have no scent and the waterfall has no water and the trees have no roots. I am aware of that, I say. It's art, a picture made with paint. Do you know how to make art? Ruby asks. Yes, I do, I say, and I puff up my chest just a little. I've always been an artist. I love drawing. Why do you love it? Ruby asked. I pause. I've never talked to anyone about this before. When I'm drawing a picture, I feel quiet inside. Ruby frowns. Quiet is boring. Not always. Ruby scratches the back of her neck with her trunk. What do you draw anyway? Bananas mostly. Things in my domain. My drawings sell at the gift store for $25 a piece with a frame. What's a frame? Ruby asks. What's a dollar? What's a gift store? I close my eyes. I'm a little sleepy, Ruby. Have you ever driven a truck? Ruby asks. I don't answer. Ivan, Ruby asks. Can Bob fly? A memory flashes past, surprising me. I think of my father snoring peacefully under the sun while I try every trick I know to wake him. Perhaps I realize he wasn't really such a sound sleeper after all. How's that foot, girl? George asks Stella. Stella pokes her trunk between the bars. She inspects George's right shirt pocket for the treat he brings her every night without fail. George doesn't always bring me treats. Stella's his favorite, but I don't mind. She's my favorite, too. Stella sees that George's pocket is empty. She gives Stella a frustrated nudge with her trunk, and Julia wiggles. Stella moves to George's left pocket and discovers a carrot. Nimbly, she moves it. Mac walks past. Toilet's plugged up in the men's bathroom, he says. Big mess. I'll take care of it, George sighs. Mac turns to leave. Before you go, Mac, George says, you might want to take a look at Stella's foot. I think it's infected again. Darn thing never does heal up right, Mac rubs his eyes. I'll keep an eye on it. Money's tight, though. Can't be calling the vet every time she sneezes. George strokes Stella's trunk. She inspects his pockets one more time, just in case. Sorry, girl, George says as he watches Mac walk away.